of weeks. Let's forget about it. I'm just at a loss for words, Jake.
Well, let's talk about the security issues, because I know that is something that you've publicly expressed. How serious do you think the threat is? And do you agree with some of your Democratic colleagues that maybe even some of your Republican colleagues are people? That are potentially dangerous.
Yeah, I don't share those views on my Republican colleagues and the fears around that. I think if there was any complicity in the events of January 6th, we shouldn't jump the gun. We shouldn't jump to conclusions. We need to wait for that investigation to play out. But we're taking the security risk seriously. I think it was my colleague Adam Kinzinger who said, you know, it's not necessarily the death threats that are made to you that you worry about. It's the ones that aren't. It's the people who are planning and not saying what they're planning to do.
On the day of the attack, I talked to two of your colleagues who had served abroad in the military, Kinzinger, whom you just mentioned, and also Congressman Gallagher. I know you're a veteran as well, having served in Iraq and then also in a different capacity in Afghanistan. Tell me what it's like being in a Capitol building surrounded by fencing that, honestly, I don't say this lightly, does resemble to me very much a war zone, not the battle part of the war zone, but like a green zone type area.
I mean, it just shows the absolute lack of trust that we've come to as a nation. You know, the Capitol used to be a place where folks could walk, you know, in front of the steps, especially if the Congress wasn't in session. It was supposed to be inviting. It's supposed to be the people's house. And to have it be walled off because we can't trust that, frankly, the people won't try to overrun it, that the tension has gotten that high, it's dispiriting, it's depressing, and it's a sad reflection on where we are as a country today. And frankly, we need to rebuild that trust. We need to work to say there are ways of addressing disputes within the political system, within our legal system, because for too long, you know, we've had politicians who are shutting down any notion of the legitimacy of the courts, of elections. And that's why you see people take to the streets. That's why you see folks taking up arms. I mean, that is absolutely, utterly unacceptable. And it's on every leader to rebuild that trust, rebuild that confidence, and get us back to a place where we can resolve disputes peacefully.
And yet, look what's going on right now. Just today in the Republican caucus, House Minority Leader Kevin McCarthy, who is one of the people who pushed the big lie, who voted to disenfranchise millions of voters after the terrorist attack based on that lie, he's down in Florida kissing Donald Trump's ring. And then up in Wyoming, your colleague Matt Gaetz is out there holding a rally against Liz Cheney, Congresswoman Cheney, who is the number three Republican who joined you in voting for impeachment. It seems like a lot of the energy in the House Republican caucus is frankly with the seditionists, with the crazy.
If Liz Cheney is the person who suffers the most from the events on January 6th politically, it'll be a very sad, sad day for my party. I have been impressed by her leadership and just the fact that this was a vote of conscience. This was not a vote that was being whipped. And I give Leader McCarthy a lot of credit for that, that this was a vote that was up to the individual member. But to see the number of folks aligning against her solely due to pressure from a base that they frankly misled. There are people making the argument, well, we have to vote to overturn this election because our supporters don't believe that it was legitimate. Well, they don't believe it was legitimate because you were lying to them, because you were playing to those fears.
Right. There have been social media posts uncovered by CNN and others from another Republican colleague of yours, Congresswoman Marjorie Taylor Greene from Georgia, where she indicated support for shooting Speaker Pelosi, where she pushed conspiracies about the Parkland shooting not being real, about Sandy Hook not being real. She was just appointed to the House Education Committee. Education. I find it kind of incredible that your party's talking about sanctioning Liz Cheney, but Marjorie Greene seems to be you know, being no punishment for her for saying these heinous things. How do you think the Republican Party should be handling Congresswoman Greene right now?
I think ultimately every member is going to be responsible for their own actions and their own words. But we can't be a party of conspiracy theories. We can't be a party of winking and nodding at some of the worst impulses that we've seen in the darkest corners of the internet. That's not how you're going to have a party that's trusted to govern. That's not how we're going to win over moderate and independent voters and say, trust us to make decisions about the future of this country. I mean, that, again, is just a dark path for the Republican Party to go down, and it's one that I'm committed not to going down. And if that means that I'm off on an island with a few, you know, lonely colleagues, so be it. I think it's important to stand up for truth. It's important to stand up and stand by our oath to the Constitution and to say there are better ways for us to govern that don't devolve into threats of political violence, into, you know, these allusions to just insane theories. I mean, that-